the most popular bands from the 70s and 80s, by far, is Queen. Here's all that you need to know to recreate Roger Taylor's drum sound. Art of Drumming is not just a YouTube channel, but also a free platform where you can find numerous drum-related courses filmed by major international artists. Head on over and join our growing community. Roger Taylor has been the drummer for the British rock band Queen since they were founded in 1970. He also played in a previous project called Smile, which was founded by Queen guitarist Brian May 2 years earlier in 1968. When Freddie Mercury joined the two and replaced the previous lead singer of Smile in 1970, they decided to change the band name to Queen. In 1971, bassist John Deacon completed the lineup and they went on to become one of the most successful rock bands ever. Up until Freddie Mercury's death in 1991, there were no lineup changes and all of Queen's worldwide hits were written and performed by these four musicians. Here's just a quick excerpt of some of their most famous songs. For this video, let's focus on their most iconic masterpiece, Bohemian Rhapsody. The first single from their album, A Night at the Opera, released in 1975, marks the international commercial breakthrough for Queen. With a pretty unconventional song structure and a lot of elements taken from opera music, the song was so different from everything else at the time that it stood out and gained a lot of recognition all over the world. Besides the music itself, the super popular music video is also pretty unique. Mama, ooh, I don't wanna die. Sometimes wish I'd never been born at all. Queen is well known for a pretty natural and warm drum sound. Throughout the 80s, this changed a little when they started using gated reverb and brought in some electronic sounds. For this video, we want to concentrate on the classic Roger Taylor drum sound from the 70s. When searching for some info on Taylor's kits, you quickly find out that he usually went for Ludwig drums back in the day and liked to use 26-inch kick drums. Since we don't have a 26-inch kick drum in our studio, we decided to get as close as possible and use our 24-inch PDP Concept bass drum. His snare and tom choices varied from time to time, and we decided to go with a classic 3-up, 2-down look you might know from many of his drum kits and went for large toms, 12, 13, 14, 16, and 18 inches. But let's begin our recreation with a snare. The snare we picked for our Queen kit is a 14x6.5 PDP Concept Maple snare. Since this drum has wood hoops and we want the attack of regular steel ones, we simply removed them and installed the steel ones from another PDP snare. We also like the look of those black nickel hoops. The drum head for our Roger Taylor snare is a Remo Emperor coated. The coated double ply head has the right warmth we need for this sound. Compared to a single ply head like the Ambassador, this one has an enhanced durability and simply doesn't sound as open. The tuning is in a medium range. Let's get back to the snare later and continue with the bass drum. The kick drum in Bohemian Rhapsody sounds more open than you might expect, and to meet the original sound, we decided to go with single-ply coated ambassadors as rezzo and batter heads. Since there is no porthole, and we needed at least a bit of muffling for the rezzo head, a felt strip installed underneath the head is a great solution. You can also find a lot of photos of Taylor's kits where he also used one or multiple felt strips himself. Here's the tuning of both drum heads. Now let's get the snare and bass drum in place and continue with the toms. Pascal started with an 18-inch floor tom and brought in an Emperor coated as batter and an Ambassador coated as rezzo head. This combination of a double-ply batter and a single-ply rezzo head is super common and a go-to for many drummers. Having coated heads on both sides leads to a pretty warm sound, and the double-ply construction of the batter head adds the right durability for rock music. After tuning the 18-inch tom to a medium-low range, Pascal went through this process again and prepared the 16, 14, and 13-inch toms in the same way. The 14-inch tom used here is actually a floor tom, but to be able to mount it as a rack too, we turned the drum around and used one of the floor tom leg brackets as a usual tom mount. This worked without any problems. The only tom that's treated different is the 12-inch one. You can find a lot of pictures showing Roger Taylor using 5 toms, with the highest one being a concert tom, so we wanted to go the same way. One trick he also used from time to time is to install a rezzo head that has a huge hole in the middle. We for example used a 10-inch hole on a 12-inch head. That way you can install the rim, keep the look of a regular tom, prevent any screws from rattling, and still get the sound of a concert tom without a rezzo head. For the batter head, we also went with an Emperor coated, as with the other toms, but had to go higher with the tuning due to the missing rezzo head. Here's the tuning of all 5 toms. Now before we can place the toms, we need to bring in a hi-hat as reference for positioning the 5 toms. Roger Taylor often played 15-inch Zildjian Avidus hats, so the first idea was to use our 14-inch Avidus hats. These just sounded too small, so Pascal went through our 15-inch hats and came up with his own combination. The top symbol is a 15-inch A Newbeat top, and the bottom symbol is a 15-inch Carib top. It's time to place the toms now. With the toms and hi-hat in place, let's bring in some more cymbals. From left to right, we went with an 18-inch A medium thin crash, 18 and 20-inch Zildjian Avidus cymbals, a 22-inch Carib ride, and an 18-inch A Zildjian China low. Now this kit really looks a lot like Roger Taylor's from back in the day. What do you think? Let us know in the comments. Now there is just one pretty essential part missing, the mics. For the bass drum, we brought in 2 mics. A large diaphragm condenser MC740 on the rezzo side for some low end, and a dynamic M88 on the batter side for the attack. When listening back to the signals, Pascal decided to bring in some muffling and placed a blanket on the batter side. Here is our bass drum sound. For the snare, we went with 2 dynamic mics, an SM57 for the top and an M201 for the rezzo side. Just as with the bass drum, we brought in some muffling after listening back to the signals. Here's a single tissue taped to the batter head of the snare. Let's quickly listen to what we ended up with. All toms are captured with biodynamic M201s. Those dynamic mics work great on toms and are a great alternative to the MD421s Roger Taylor often used back in the day. The overheads are 2 large diaphragm condenser M90 Pro X's, and for the hi-hat we chose a ribbon M160 to get more of a warm hi-hat sound instead of a super sharp one you would get with a small diaphragm condenser mic, for example. For the room, we placed another large diaphragm MC740, and with this last mic in place, our Queen drum kit is ready for Pascal's take on Bohemian Rhapsody. Enjoy! We'll be right back.
of a man.
Scaramouche, Scaramouche, will you do the fandango?
Thunderbolts and lightning, very, very frightening me.
Galileo, Galileo,
Galileo,
Galileo.
I'm just a poor boy, nobody loves me. Easy come, easy go, will you let me go?
Bismillah,
no, we will not let you go.
Let him go!
Bismillah,
we will not let you go.
Let him go!
Bismillah,
we will not let you go.
Let me go!
We will not let you go.
Let me go!
Never let you go.
Never
let me go!
Oh, mamma mia, mamma mia!
Mamma mia, let me go!
Beelzebub has a devil put aside for me.
If you're interested in the audio mixing process of our Queen drum sound, head over to ArtOfDrumming.com. You'll find free detailed mixing breakdown videos for many of our recreating videos over there. Now let us know, how did you like our recreation of Queen's drum sound, and which Queen song has the best drum sound in your opinion? Post your thoughts in the comments, make sure to subscribe to our channel, and keep an eye out for the next recreation episodes in the future.